Thank you for attending, everyone. I'm Stefan Edeler, CTO of S3D.net, and in the next 15 minutes, I'll give a very brief overview of who we are, what we do, but primarily how latency plays an important, probably even a crucial factor in online gaming and its infrastructure. So, well, 15 minutes is probably not enough to go that deep into the details. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me after the presentation or send me an email. It will be covered at the last slide. So very quickly, who are we? We were founded in 2002 in Rotterdam, and we were in the business of providing game servers towards consumers. Back in those early years, there was not really a gaming model. If a gaming studio would make a game, they would just put the server files online somewhere and just let the community, the people playing the game, figure out the rest. And that's where companies like us back then came in to provide a service to consumers to host these game servers in a data center so people could play that game online together with their friends. This started changing about 5 years from then, around 2007, 8, 2009, when game developers and publishers started to take control of their game, of the online experience of their game. So it went from being an afterthought left to the community to the first baby steps to what is now known as the games as a service model or live service games. We were at the right position at the right time to join this transition. Started working with THQ, EA, Ubisoft, the big names, and eventually got acquired in 2019 by one of our customers, but are continuing to serve the whole game industry since then. So even though we are a Ubisoft company, our largest client is not Ubisoft, but it's actually EA Games, for example. Moving on. So you might see familiar titles just to indicate that, okay, we actually do know what gaming is and how latency ties into that. Latency is not just relevant for gaming, but also for everything related to gaming. Think voice over IP, voice services. In this case, voice services being used a lot by gamers. And we are actively trying to serve not just the current markets, but also the new markets, building out more locations for new gamers to lower the latency. Because once you give gamers low latency, the market side will come. One example is South Africa. There were no local servers for any game for many, many years there. We started there two, three years ago. And nowadays, for most AAA games, they actually think about that country and the whole south part of Africa to put some servers there, not just with us, but also with other companies and our competitors. So you will go from a situation where there's nothing to putting it on a map. And for players, having a millisecond of 10 compared to having 200 plus milliseconds when they have to connect back to London is, of course, a world of difference. So how does latency matter in gaming? There's a few important factors, because always when I start discussions with vendors or suppliers, they think when I talk about low latency, they think financial services. Financial services where you have two, three main hubs around the world where you need to push every single or subset of 1 millisecond or less of the connection just to get in more financial transactions. While less latency is nice for gaming, I'm not talking about squeezing up one or two or half of a millisecond of connections. It's about optimizing 50 plus hubs in the world, the major population areas, and ensuring your game is as close as possible to all these gamers, using the best possible network paths that you have to available to yourself. As such, you're not seeing gaming companies on the forefront of acquiring highly specialized infrastructure equipment, but one footnote that I do see this changing with the cloud gaming and hybrid streaming models, which will be coming up in one of my future slides, because there's not just longer the latency from your data center to the player that matters, but also your encoding time of your stream, your bitrate, and the efficiency of your whole streaming pipeline. So back to the gaming as a service model, also known as live services. So that's important that you retain your players, preferably that your players log in daily to keep playing your game. Make sure they are exposed every day as often as possible to your rewards, your skins, your seasonal actions, your battle pass, basically your whole microtransaction system to keep your game profitable and running in online setting. So that experience needs to be flawless, and latency can make or break that whole ordeal. So in the next couple of slides, I'll be covering the following topics. Global coverage. As mentioned already, you need to be sure that you're close enough to your audience and be in control of your infrastructure. You need to keep your traffic local, reach your eyeballs, preferably in one hub. I'll be giving some examples there, because the normal internet, as we know it, as you would get it in those countries, is far from optimized. It's usually optimized for costs, but not optimized for low latency applications. I also need to touch on the hybrid model, which nowadays no gaming company goes with a single cloud provider anymore or buys 100% of the hardware for their own data centers. It's all a mix nowadays, but that does add a lot of latency concerns in the mix. Moving on, to keep in mind of the time. As I mentioned in the introduction, gaming has truly gone global. No longer can you just focus on the single continent, just Europe or Asia or US, and think your game will be successful. The competition is global, so you need to be global to make sure that your game survives. So you need to work with a partner, any partner, not us, just an example. And to make sure that your game can be as many locations as you can, or as your matchmaker of your game can actually support. I also strongly recommend that if you go into this business, that you try to keep control of your infrastructure or work with a partner which has full control of the infrastructure. And they're not just reselling multiple different other suppliers, because when you have a problem with your game, with your players, you need to be able to tell your players very quickly what is going on and what is wrong, or you risk the community, Twitter, social blowing up, causing player dissatisfaction and players to leave your game, thus players not spending money. Slightly touching on COVID, also in the gaming, it's been absolutely crazy what's happening. For us, and also for our competitors, we see that all of us are more than doubling or even tripling in size, in the amount of gamers playing, in the session time of gamers increasing, in the amount of data being pushed. This work from home situation, it's definitely also a lot more people actually gaming from home, maybe during work, maybe not, but we see a big increase in usage. Second very important thing is to keep your traffic local. So what many parties sometimes forget, that thinking, okay, you go to a data center, you put your equipment there, you sign with one supplier, and you're done. If you're running a traditional e-commerce site or HTTP-based platform, which is not very latency dependent, then it's perfectly fine. But if you're running a gaming application or something else which requires low latency, you need to start working out deals with all the major ISPs in every region where you intend to serve the market. It's unfortunately the way it is, that you no longer can rely on the quote-unquote public internet to always offer you a full low latency packet loss free connection to the end users of these ISP networks. So you need to build your make your business case, build your relationships, contact all of them, meet them at the events, and make sure you establish a direct connection with all these large parties involved. Sometimes it goes directly by being in the same data center. Sometimes it goes via an internet exchange, for example, the Amsterdam Internet Exchange here in the Netherlands. So let me give you an example where this definitely goes wrong by default. For example, in Dubai, the internet situation is extremely fragmented. When we first got there, there were many problems with many of the traffic to their neighboring countries, or actually even their competing ISPs inside of the Emirates would be going via Europe. Their arguments were basically, yes, but it doesn't matter. We always do it like this. It's just a detour, but your applications will work fine. Or they ask us, well, then just place your gaming cluster in our ISP data center. And the competitor would also come to us and also say, just place your gaming services in our data center. So that doesn't work. That doesn't scale, because these gamers in that country want to play together and not just play with people from their own internet service provider. So that takes a lot of, again, effort, a lot of monitoring, a lot of measurements to make sure that you can detect these kind of problems in the internet, and then you can place actions on them to try and fix them. Reaching out to the technical teams of these ISPs, asking the users to reach out to their technical help desks of their internet service provider to create the tickets, to gain traction and momentum to resolve the internet problem. And this is just an example of the Middle East, but it can happen anywhere. And if you're running a low latency application, you need to be aware of these things and try to preempt them. One tip I would suggest there is, for example, make use of RIPE Atlas probes to also do some traces from a user point of view back to your own network and your own devices to see if there's any weird, inconsistent routing going on. Another example here was going from a Pakistan to Dubai, which normally is supposed to go over a single sea cable. But again, also here, because of the internet by default is not optimized for low latency, it again was a detour via Europe. And if you play a high intensive shooter at 150 milliseconds compared to playing it versus 22 milliseconds, it's an extremely noticeable difference. So that's something to take into account. Just checking my time. Yeah, I need to hurry up. Another thing I need to cover, because with gaming, you attract attacks, and not just few, but you attract a lot of them. There's a lot of emotion involved when playing games. There's also monetization involved, Twitch streams, YouTube streams, people donating, and people wanting to see their star playing their game with them. And there's also always people willing to destroy the sandbox and try to attack the server that this popular streamer is playing on. So you see constantly being attacked. And when you run, in this case, a gaming application, you need to be prepared for it. So you get a lot of free stress tests and other nastiness directed to your infrastructure and to your network. So why does the traditional solutions do not work for gaming? The traditional anti-DDoS services, they require you to reroute your traffic to their specialized scrubbing centers in the case of an attack. But with gaming, it usually means that by the time the rerouting is complete, that the game will already be crashed and your users will already be disconnected. The second problem is that by rerouting from your data center to a third-party data center, yet your servers are still in your data center, you add round-trip time, you add latency to the total connection, so also to the total connection of your players. In some locations, there might not be one of these scrubbing centers at all, meaning that you might even introduce more latency to your players. So you need to build a solution which can deal with this this locally. And how we solved it, we created something from scratch. It's not that difficult. I think many people can do this if they put their mind on it. But basically, locally in every data center, we do the scrubbing of our gaming traffic. So instead of having to reroute players all over the place, you do it locally. But you do need to be in control of your infrastructure. That's the only thing you need to be. You need to be in control of your from your application stack towards your server stack towards your network stack. And if you have some smart people in your company, I'm sure you can figure this out, how to protect this. We managed to do it as well, and we're not that genius kind of people. Then I want to touch on the final piece of the puzzle. With gaming, hybrid multi-cloud approaches is now the default. We've gone from a situation where people were running everything in their own data centers to situations where people were running everything on a single cloud provider to nowadays a situation where most gaming companies are looking to diverse and run their burst load across multiple cloud providers, yet keep a base load in their own data centers or on one of the services like, for example, we offer. But the problem with the public cloud is that they don't all have a worldwide offering. So if you're looking to use a single or two cloud providers for not just Europe, US, but also for Russia, Middle East, Africa, Latin America, or China, you'll find out that such a party does not exist. And you have to make a mix of different offerings to have a valid burst option for your capacity needs. So this complicates game capacity planning, especially if a region does not have any cloud coverage. To keep the latency under your own control, the only option you have there is to still buy capacity for the peak. Fortunately, as also my previous presenters have mentioned, the industry is busy filling those gaps in the cloud coverage maps. But there's going to be a multi-year effort before that is finally completed. But one thing to keep into account that with cloud provider networks, due to their sheer size and their optimization for their most common tasks, which is not gaming, but it's actually pushing bits, pushing traffic, pushing video, means you will see your latency fluctuate. You will see congestion. You will see non-optimal routing. You definitely need to be monitoring this. If you're not monitoring this and you're not monitoring your cloud network quality, you're going to be surprised by people complaining on social that something is not working right. My advice is there not to avoid the cloud because it makes 100% financial sense to use them for your bursting needs. But it is to develop your tooling to actively monitor where your players are, what the performance is from the cloud to these players, and what the performance is from the from your own network to these players.
Stefan, finalize your presentation due to time?
One slide, that's it.
Okay.
You can actively support them, and you can shift these players from a bad performing hyperscaler to a good performing hyperscaler. Moving on to my last slide, future developments. Apologies for running over time. So cloud streaming and hybrid streaming, as the next presenter also touches on this subject, I'll keep this very, very brief. But what I see from my infrastructure point of view, providing infrastructure to gaming companies, ecosystems are now being formed of companies who aim to be the Netflix of gaming. Everyone is interested in a piece of the pie. Hyperscalers like Google are running Stadia, Amazon with Luna, and game companies try their own thing. And there are many independent companies building also their own solutions to become the number one. However, game streaming or hybrid or full streaming bring additional latency problems to the table. For a game streaming model, you want to have a latency of 30 milliseconds or less to your players. But you also have to deal with latency involved in the encoding process of your stream, choosing the right bit rates, the compute and your GPUs. So the total latency picture becomes a lot more complicated to try and keep it as low as possible for your end users. So in the future, we're no longer talking about optimizing network paths. It's about optimizing the whole streaming pipeline of your game, including the network. I can give one example there. What I see finally in the gaming is that games going from a single process to multiple different small processes, where some processes might run in the big centralized data centers, and some processes which need very low latency to the end users might run closer at very small locations at the edge. So that's the edge computing scenarios. Just for example, look at Flight Simulator, which streams highly detailed maps data from the cloud to your PC while you're flying. That's not very latency sensitive, so that's being done from the central Azure locations. But if we're talking about hitbox calculations, player positions, actions between players, those are expected to be closer to the players at the edges with specialized microservices. So with that, wrapping up, I believe we're at the steps of the next revolution in gaming. And I'm personally looking very much forward to the games coming out in the next 5 years who will start to utilize this new technology. So thank you for your attention.